Good day, Grade 12s. Welcome to this next lesson in physical science. Before we carry on, I would like to again encourage you to join us on the TuEnable platform. This lesson is brought to you by TuEnable.org. And the reason I would like to suggest that you join the TuEnable platform is, like I keep saying, there are multitudes of material. It's just all that's sitting there waiting for you to use. There are multiple choice questions, there are test sheets, there are exam papers. It's out there waiting for you, and all there with memos except for this paper, and it's there for you to use, as well as there are videos. Okay, and if you join the grade 12 physical science class, then you can message me and you can tell me, hey, Miss Rennie, I'm really struggling with section, or I'm struggling with that section, and we can focus our lessons on specific sections that you are struggling on. So that is what I would really like to invite you to do. In the meantime, I'm going to carry on going through the June Common Paper of Physical Science. I'm probably going to finish it, so then we're going to move on to the chemistry paper. Let's get started. So question 8 says, the diagram below shows a spaceship. Okay, there's the spaceship there, that funny looking thing over there, with a mass of 3,500 kilograms, traveling in the vacuum of space in an orbit about Earth, which has a mass of about 5.96 times by 10 to the 24 kilograms at a constant speed. There is a distance between them of 8.53 times by 10 to the 6 meters, okay, between the Earth and the spaceship centers. And firstly, it says define Newton's law of universal gravitation. Now, as I've stated before, the first definition that they ask you in the question, in every question, is telling you what you need to be using to solve this problem. So if you hadn't already worked out that you should be using Newton's law of universal gravitation, here's the hint, okay? Define Newton's law of universal gravitation. Now, I'm going to write it out in formula form, but you may not do that. What it states is that every object in the universe is a to every other object with a force that is directly proportional to the product of the masses and inversely proportional to the distance between their centers squared. Okay, so you need to learn that definition. If you just write down the equation, then you will not get any marks. Okay, you have to learn the definitions. And I know it's tedious to learn the definitions, grade 12s, but you can lose or gain up to 10% in an exam paper if you just know your definitions. So the next question says, calculate the gravitational force that the Earth exerts on the spaceship. So what we want? We want F. So the nice thing about this is that we've got the mass of the spaceship, we have the mass of the Earth, we have the distance between the objects in meters, which is great because that's the SI unit, and we have big G because it's a universal constant and it's on your formula sheet. So actually this is a really easy question. We're going to go F is equal to big G, which is 6.67 times by 10 to the negative 11 times by the mass of the spaceship, it doesn't matter which order you do it in, multiplied by the mass of the Earth, which is 5.96 times by 10 to the 24, all divided by the distance in meters squared. So that's going to be 8.53 times by 10 to the 6, all squared. So now we can put that in our calculators. There it is. Okay, so now it is 6.67 exponent, there's going to be this button here, times by 10 to the negative 11. Okay, and what I'm going to do, just to make sure we understand what we're doing, is I'm going to put brackets in. Okay. Multiplied by 3,500, multiplied by bracket 5.96, exponent 24, and I'm going to close the bracket, and then I'm going to go down, and I'm going to go bracket 8.53, exponent 6, all squared. Okay, and I'm going to take it all to the other side, and then we're going to do equals. And the answer is 19,122.39. Now, if you did this in stages, you might get a slightly different answer, but that's rounding errors. So this is 19,122.35, and what is it? It's newtons. Newtons. Right, now it says, how does the force exerted by the spaceship on the Earth compare to the force calculated in the previous question? In other words, What I actually want to do was erase everything. What it's saying is, how does the force exerted by the spaceship on the Earth compare to the force calculated in the previous question? Right, so only greater than, smaller than, or equal to. So we worked out what the force it was exerted on the spaceship by the Earth. Now they want to know, what is the force exerted by the spaceship on the Earth And you remember that Newton's third law says that object A will exert a force on object B, then object B will exert an equal and opposite force on object A. So the correct answer is equal to. They are equal to. And now it says, name and state the Newton's laws of motion used to make a choice. I've just said it. It is Newton's third law. And the law states, when object A exerts a force on object B simultaneously exerts an equal force on object A in the opposite direction. You may not say, please do not write, for every action is an equal and opposite reaction. I know that people have been telling you that since you were 10 years old, okay? But you may not write that. It is not correct. Stated, okay? When Newton stated that, he put provisos around it that were misquoted, okay? So you cannot state that. You have to state, if object A exerts a force on object B will apply an equal and opposite force on object A. Right, now it says, due to a change in the distance between the Earth and the spaceship centers, the force increased by a factor of 4. Calculate the new distance between the Earth and the spaceship. Okay, so we know that F is equal to G, M1, M2 over R squared. Okay, now that is the original equation. And the original force, okay, now there are a couple of ways you can do it. You can actually substitute in numbers, or we can actually just work it out. So this is the original. Okay, now we have a new force. So do you agree we can solve for R? Yeah, you can say R squared is equal to G M1 M2 over F0. Okay, do you agree with that? Okay, now you've got a different thing happening, which now you've got R new squared is equal to G M1 M2 over F new. But F new is equal to 4 times FO. Do you agree? F new is 4 times FO. So what you need to realize is that what is happening. Think about this. I want you to think. Okay, you've got the normal, the new force is 4 times the original force. So we could say that R new is equal to 4 times F0. Okay, you with me? So R new is going to be 4 times that. So it's actually going to be R new squared is going to be a quarter of g m1 m2 over f original, right? So therefore, the new radius squared is a quarter of the old radius, okay, squared. Okay, this was the old radius squared. So we can say that r new squared is equal to a quarter of the original distance squared, right? So do you agree that rn is going to be a half the original distance? Okay, because we can square root both sides. So we can just take this and divide this by 2, and we get an answer of 4.26 times by 10, actually it's 27, times by 10 to the 6 meters. You do not need to put numbers in. And the reason I say this is because of the fact that you should know that force is inversely proportional to 1 over r squared. Now, grade 12s, you could have put numbers in, and if you look at the memo, which I will put up onto, well, I'll get someone to put up onto this platform after we've done this paper, they did put numbers in. But the reason I did it without numbers is because they often ask it in the final exams without numbers, and then you have to work out using this theory here. Okay, so you need to understand that you can do it theoretically without numbers. Right, question 9. It says, two identical objects, P and Q, of mass 10 kilograms each, are moving side by side with an initial velocity of 5.5 meters per second east on a horizontal surface. Okay, so you got two identical objects, P and Q, and they're moving side by side with both with an initial velocity of 5.5 meters per second, and they're going east. Okay, the following graphs show the net force experienced by each object. Now please remember that F net is equal to what? F net equals mass times acceleration. And these are identical objects, so their masses are the same. So really, what is this graph? It's an acceleration graph. This is what this is. This is an acceleration graph because their mass is the same. So this is an acceleration graph of of object P, and an acceleration graph of object Q. Okay. So now it says calculate the total impulse experienced by object Q in 10 seconds. Okay. They want the impulse. But what is impulse? Impulse is defined as F delta T, right? F delta T. So if you think about that, what is that? That is the same. This is F and this is delta T. So what we are really looking at is the area under the graph. How cool is that? That's the area under the graph. So we need to work that out. So therefore, the impulse, and we're looking at Q here, is going to be the first triangle there, which is going to be a half times by 2 times by 10 plus, again, a half, because it's another triangle. This distance here is 2, but this is minus 10. Right, plus this area here, which is a rectangle, this goes from 4 to 10, so that's 6 times by minus 10. So do you agree that these two cancel each other out, because that's plus 10 and that's minus 10, so you get minus 60. And remember, what is the formula? It's force times delta T. Force is newtons, so therefore this is newtons seconds. So therefore, we can say it's minus 60 newtons per second. And that there is the total impulse experienced by Q. Right, now it says, okay, so we worked out that it was minus 60. Now it says, compare without using calculations the total impulse for object P with that of object Q. Write down only greater than, less than, or equal to. So it is pretty obvious that the area here is much bigger than that area, so I can say that it is greater than. Okay, greater than. Now it says, calculate the final velocity of object Q. Okay, well, we know that impulse is equal to change in momentum, right? And we know that our impulse was minus 60 is equal to mvf minus mvi, which can be written as mvf minus vi is equal to minus 60. Okay, the masses we do have, they're both 10 kgs. So if it's minus 60 is equal to 10 times the final velocity minus the initial velocity of 5.5. So we can rearrange it and we can say that this becomes, if we divide this, we get 6 minus 6, okay, is equal to VF minus 5.5. And then finally, you can go across, so you get minus 6 plus 5.5 equals VF. So the final velocity is going to be minus 0.5 meters per second, which means, yes, I'm right. So therefore, that means it's in the opposite direction. Okay, right. Now it says, 2-point charges of magnitude 4 nanocoulombs. What is N? N is nano, and nano is 10 to the minus 9 nano. Guys, you need to learn this. It's milli, micro, nano. Okay, there's pico as well, but you don't really need to know that one. So milli is 10 to the minus 3, micro is 10 to the minus 6, nano, it's easy to remember because it's nano 9, it's 10 to the minus 9, and pico is 10 to the minus 12. And you need to know it because you need to put the correct SI units into the formula, okay? So 2-point charges of magnitudes 4 nanocoulombs and minus 6 nanocoulombs are placed at points N, C respectively. These charges are respectively 20 millimeters and 25 millimeters away from point R in the diagram below. Okay, so what's wrong with these numbers? They should be in meters, just pointing that out. Now it says, draw the electric field pattern formed between the 2-point charges. Okay, so we know that this is positive and this is negative, so I'm just gonna draw it up here. We've got a positive point charge and you've got a negative point charge. The electric field always acts as if it is a negative, so it is going to be going from the positive to the negative. So it goes straight across and it should touch, okay, should touch. And then it's gonna be drawing these beautiful lines, it shouldn't cross. Okay, and it should always be going at 90 degrees to the surface. And then you've got this going in and then going in and in, that's obviously the negative side. And then this, they're going out, 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 and that is obviously the positive side. That's something you need to learn. You need to know that this is a positive point charge and that the electric field lines always go from positive to negative. Now it says, calculate the net electric field at R due to the 2-point charges. Okay, so there's a formula on your formula sheet which says that EA is equal to, well, just says actually E is equal to K Q over R squared, where E is your electric field strength, Q is your charge in coulombs, and R is your displacement, or your distance, should I say, between the two centers, okay? Now, obviously, the electric field that this is experiencing at R is going to be dependent on both A and C. So we need to work out the electric field at R based on the charge at A and the electric field at R based on the charge at C. It's the sum of the two. So EA is equal to KQA over this distance here, Okay, R A R all squared, which is going to give us K is a constant of 9 times by 10 to the 9. Q is going to be 4 times by 10 to the minus 9. And now you have to convert that into meters. And millimeters to meters is 10 to the minus 3. So it's going to be all over 20 times by 10 to the negative 3, all squared. Okay, so let's pop that into our calculators. So we're clearing and we're going 9 exponent, that did not work, let's try again. So we're going to put a bracket, we're going to go 9 exponent 9, close bracket, times by open bracket, 4 exponent negative 9, close bracket, all over bracket, 20 exponent negative 3, close bracket, squared, move over, equals. So that is equal to 90,000 newtons per coulomb. And we know the direction of this because this is positive. And we know that electric fields always go away from the positive. So therefore, this is to the right. Okay, now we need to work out this effect of the C. Okay, so we're going to go EC. So EC is equal to KQC over R squared, which is 9 times by 10 to the 9. All over. Now the negative doesn't match it too much, it just shows you the direction, so you don't fill it in. It's 6 times by 10 to the negative 9, all over 25 times by 10 to the negative 3. Why? Because we're changing it into meters, and then it's all squared. So let's do that. And we're going to go bracket 9 exponent 9 bracket times bracket 6 exponent negative 9 bracket. And guys, your button for exponent might actually just say exp. That's the same thing. Okay, so then we've got bracket 25 exponent negative 3, close bracket, squared, move it over, equals 86,400. That's 86,400. And in which direction is that? That is also to the right. So therefore, the electric field that R experiences is the sum of these two. So therefore, the electric field strength at R is going to be 90,000 plus 86,400, which is going to be 176,400 newtons per coulomb to the right. And I can draw an arrow that means to the right. You guys, however, need to make sure that you write the words to the right. Okay, which can also be written as 1.764 times by 10 to the 5, but don't worry about that too much. Right, now let's do this question. Okay, I just want to erase all the writing. It says, if the distance between the two charges A and C is reduced by 15 millimeters, so the distance is reduced by 15 millimeters, calculate the electrostatic force that charge A exerts on charge C. Okay, that's pretty easy. It's not complicated. F is equal to K, Q1, Q2 over R squared. K, Q1, Q2 over R squared. F is equal to K, Q1, Q2 over R squared. Okay, the K is going to be the normal unit that we have, which is 9 times by 10 to the 9. Q is the charge on the first letter, our first charge, which is 4 times by 10 to the negative 9. The other one is going to be 6 times by 10 to the negative 9. And again, you don't include the negative, because when it comes to charges, positive and negative just tell you whether or not you're going to be attracting or repelling. So in this case, this is positive and this is negative, and opposites attract, so there's going to be a force of attraction between them, okay? Then we want to do the distance, but the distance has been reduced by 15 millimeters. So what is it? We could say, well, originally it was 45 millimeters, but now we've reduced it by 15 millimeters, which makes it 30 millimeters. But remember, this is millimeters. So what do we have to do? We have to go 30 times by 10 to the negative 3, all squared. And then we just pop this into our calculators. So we go 9 exponent 9, close bracket, times by, open bracket, 4 exponent negative 9, close bracket, times open bracket, 6 exponent negative 9. Now I know I might be overdoing things by doing the little times in between every time, but some people's calculators don't know how to do that, so I'm showing you how to do it, okay? All over bracket, 30 exponent negative 3, close bracket, squared, move it over, equals. And that's 3 over 12,500, but let's get real, we don't write things like that, so we press the SD button, and that becomes, yes, okay, 0,00024. I get 0,00024, which can be written as 2,4 times by 10 to the negative, let's go, 1, 2, 3, 4, negative 4 newtons, and it's a force of attraction. There we go. Okay, and that is the end of the physics paper. Yay. So now we can move on to chemistry. Okay. So we're going to start off by looking at the chemistry paper, and we're going to again start by looking at question 2. I've asked that the chemistry paper be uploaded into the revision same week that you would find the physics paper. If you don't find it, please message me and I will make sure it gets uploaded. In the meantime, they traditionally start off the long questions by looking at a nice long question using a table on organic chemistry. Organic chemistry is a huge part of your exam paper. So guys, I hate saying this as a teacher, I'm not really going to say this, but if you have to spot learn for the final exams, which you don't, okay, ever, but if you had to, you want to study your organic chemistry, okay? If you get all your organic chemistry right, you will pass the paper. However, our aim is not for you to just pass the paper, it is for you to do amazingly well. So that means we're going to make sure you know all the sections, and I really suggest you never spot learn for any section of any work ever for any subject. Okay, so let's get started. Now that I've had my little rant, it says letters A through to F represent 6 organic compounds. Okay, fair enough. It says write down the general formula for the homologous series to which compound B belongs. Okay, so what you need to understand is what they're really doing here is making sure you understand the words general formula and homologous series for that compound, okay? Before, in the olden days, ye olden days, they used to ask you for the definition. They'd say, what is the definition of an homologous Baker series. What is the definition of a general formula? Now, they just put it out as a question, okay? So it's a sneaky question. So it says, what is the general formula for the homologous series to which compound B belongs? So compound B is ethene, which means it's an alkene, right? And if it's an alkene, it means its general formula is going to be CnH2n. CnH2n, and you guys need to learn these formulas. Formulae. Okay, now it says name the homologous series to which compound D belongs. Compound D. Sure, so there you got CH3, CH, CH3, CH2, there's a C double bonded O, and there's a CH3. So if you've got double bonded O's, okay, what do we have double bonded O's in? We've got double bonded O's in aldehydes, ketones, and carboxylic acids. Do you agree? But carboxylic acids are C double bonded O, OH, right? And there's no OH here, so it's not a carboxylic acid. So then our options are aldehyde versus ketone. Both of those have got just a double bonded O. And here's the way I remember it. Aldehyde has to have the double bond on the end. Aldehyde is on the end. And this is not the last carbon. There's one short of the last carbon. So therefore, this is a ketone. Ketone. Now it says, write down the letter of the compound that represents an aldehyde. Well, it's obviously not that one. It's this one here, methanol. Methanol is the name for the aldehyde, okay? So it says, and also please be careful in the exams, they say write down the letter of the compound. Don't write methanol, okay? Write aldehyde, okay? So, I mean, write E. Sorry, I got distracted because it said my server connection failed, but now it says it's all perfect again, so this is good. So, the letter the compound represents is E, but I'm going to write here aldehyde, and the reason I'm doing that is because this is going to disappear soon, and I may need this information again. Now it says, compound B undergoes polymerization. Compound B undergoes polymerization, okay, to form a polymer that is used to make plastic products. Okay, so we're talking polymerization, right? It says give a reason why compound B is classified as unsaturated. Well, that's very easy. It's because it's got double bonds. Ethene is double bonded, which means that it's got the opportunity to break that double bond and add extra anything on, hydrogens, carbons, whatever. So therefore, we can see that that is definitely a double bond, and therefore it is unsaturated. Okay, now it says, classify the polymerization as addition or condensation. And the correct answer is that it is addition. And the reason it's addition is because we are going to be breaking this double bond and we're going to go through addition. We're going to do an addition reaction, okay? Condensation, you're looking for a C double bonded O, OH. You're looking for something that can make water because condensation, the byproduct of the condensation reaction is water. There is no double bonded OOH there to make water. Now it says, write down the condensed structural formula of the polymer. Okay, and that's the only part that's difficult, and it's not that difficult. Okay, so what we are saying is that they want to know what is the basic unit for ethene. And remember what happens with the ethene. Ethene is made up of two carbons and four hydrogens, and it normally has a double bond. But what happens is the double bond breaks and ends up with two arms here, and you end up with that. And then that there is what is actually your unit. That is your the formula for the unit of the polymer. However, they ask for condensed structural formula. So we need to write this out in the form of condensed structural formula. So it becomes C, and you draw your bond through it to show that we have multiples of that. CH2, CH2, and then your bracket and your N, and your line across the bracket to show that we have bonds across there as well. Okay, right, moving on. Now it says write down the IUPAC name of compound C. Compound C. Okay, so in order to write down the IUPAC name, I actually want, the first thing we need to do is see if there are any double bonds, and there aren't, okay. If you're a little bit concerned, you can actually write this out to make it a CH2, CH3, so you could actually cross that out and write C with two hydrogens and a C with three hydrogens there. That might be easier for you to do. Then the next thing we need to do is identify if there are anything in here that's weird, and there's a bromine over here, okay? Then what we need to do is identify the longest main branch. So let's do that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I think I'm looking at a 6, okay? So it's definitely 6, so that means it's hex, okay? And it's all single bonds, so it's an hexane. Now what we need to do is count from the side that is closest to the nearest branch. So I'm saying that this here is my main chain. There, that is my main chain there. Okay, so if I count along here, 1, 2, 3, do you agree that this would be a branch, but it'd be my third carbon? Oh, sorry, my main chain goes down here. Oh, let me just rearrange that. Sorry, guys. Let's try again. My main chain is going to be, yeah, there it goes, all the way along there, and along there, and along there. There's my main chain. So if I go along this way, I've got 1, 2, 3 carbons, so that would be a branch on the third carbon. Or if I go 1, 2, this would be a branch on my second carbon. So that means I need to be counting from this side. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Right. So let's do this. The first thing we have is a bromine, but we could say bromo, and it's on the second carbon. Right, so it is 2-bromo. Then on the fourth carbon, there is this carbon here, which makes a methyl group. So it's 4-methyl, and then it's just hexane. Nice and easy, hey? I've just taken it quite a long way to do it. Okay. Now let's look at this one, and I'm actually going to draw this out a little bit easier for us to see. So there is a carbon with three hydrogens on it, 1, 2, 3. There is a carbon which has got one carbon above it with three hydrogens on it, that's that. And then there's a hydrogen attached to it, okay. And then it's got another carbon with two hydrogens attached to it. Okay, then there's a carbon with a double bonded O, and then there is a carbon with three hydrogens. So do you agree that we know, because we've already named this already, that this is a ketone, which means that this here is obviously part of the main chain. We know that. So now we need to find the longest main chain. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It doesn't make a difference. So I'm going to be boring, and I'm going to go straight across. Whee! There we go. So do you agree there's a methyl group here? Okay. Now, here's the trick. Okay. You always should count from whatever is the functional group. And the functional group in this case is double bonded O. Right? So therefore, we're going to count this side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So do you agree that this is pentanone, okay? So this is pentanone, but it has a double bonded O on your second carbon. And you need to tell people where that second, where the double bonded O is. So it is called pentan-2-one, okay? Then we need to tell them that there's a methyl group, okay? So it's a methyl group. And where is that methyl group? It's on carbon 4. And that's how you name these things. You need to think about how you would draw it. And that's how you go about naming it. Right, now it says compound F is a secondary alcohol. Secondary alcohol. Write down the structural formula of compound F. Okay, so let's think about that. Primary alcohol has got the hydroxyl on the first carbon or the end carbon. A secondary alcohol is a carbon, the hydroxyl group is on a carbon that's attached to at least one other carbon. Okay, so in other words, we're going to have, how many are there? Four. One, two, oh, sorry, I don't know why I did that. One, two, three, four. And then we need an hydroxyl group, okay, that's on a carbon that's joined to at least one other carbon. So that there is your secondary carbon, okay? And every single one of these has a hydrogen on it, and you may not leave the hydrogens out, okay? And another thing, you may not draw OH, okay? The Department of Education has strictly said that you may not leave out the line between the O and the H. They want you to show that you know that oxygen has got two bonds. And the reason for that is because they had a whole bunch of students that used to write HO, which kind of implied that hydrogen would have two arms, which doesn't, okay, or two bonds. So now they insist that you write a separate bond between the oxygen and hydrogen, and if you don't do it, you're not going to get the marks. So please be careful and do that. Okay, and the last question for today, it says that they want the IUPAC name of a chain isomer of compound F, a chain isomer of compound F. Okay, so what we're doing is we're really saying that we can rearrange this. It still has to be an hydroxyl, but all that's going to happen is, I mean, it's still going to be an alcohol, okay, but the only thing is that it's going to have the, it can't be as long. Okay, so in other words, it has to be an isomer of it. That didn't make any sense. Let me show you. So you got carbon, carbon, carbon. So in order for this to be a chain isomer, your hydroxyl must still be on the second carbon. But what you can do is you still need four carbons. So then you have to have your carbon also, the fourth carbon also, on the next carbon, yeah, the second carbon. In other words, you still want your hydroxyl group on your second carbon, but because you need four carbons to make sure that it is an isomer and not something new, you need to move this fourth carbon. So they don't want the drawing, they want the name. So now this has got three carbons in the main chain, so it is going to be prop. And you need to tell them that it's on the second carbon, so it's propan-2-ol, and there is a methyl group on the second carbon, so it's 2-methylpropan-2-ol. Right, and that's as far as we're going for today. Please join me tomorrow as we finish going, well, not finish, we continue going through paper 2. Have a great day.